He was universally known as Mr. Football. He was indestructible. He was dead at 62. He was E.J. Ted Whitten.
To him, as to a lot of other people, Ted Whitten is a legend. Now, after a record 321 games of league football, Ted Whitten's hanging up his boots.
There's only one Ted Whitten. I don't think there'll ever be another one. These fellas are born.
Well, Ted, how does it feel to be walking down this lane, approaching the ground for your last game?
It feels bloody awful, David.
Does it?
I don't feel very happy about it at all.
He shouldn't have to retire.
But you can't keep going on forever, can you?
Oh, no, but still, he's still good.
I loved EJ. He was special.
Stuck it right up him! That's what you did!
The stuff with the big V, the lap around the MCG, they go beyond the normal footy folklore stuff.
I want a taking purpose for football all the time! You've got to inspire me!
What a player and what a leader.
He was such a showman, such a great player, certainly the best player I've seen.
Tough for, skillful, and he had everything.
There was no bigger personality in the game, and you'd be hard-pressed today to find another one.
Still my number one.
My emotions were going all over the place. You know, I was so proud to be able to be doing it with Dad.
I can't remember another sporting moment like it. I mean, there was this eerie silence.
That's the respect I had for the man.
That's burnt in my memory.
It was incredible. Amazing.
I wasn't there, Mike. No, I missed it.
He said, "Sparrow, I'll never forget what you've done for me today."
These memories for me forever, they're special.
I played with Ted Whitten.
I can still hear him talking to me every day.
As the crowd actually leaves their seats in front of the members and runs down to the fence of the MCG to honour this great man. His son's giving him a big hug, and Teddy Boy is just in his element.
Well, Ted, this is probably an all too familiar path for you, the boundary line at the MCG.
Yes, Mike, it brings back a lot of memories for myself, and back in 1995, it's amazing to be back here and just think that we're into the 20th year of Dad's passing. Yeah.
What better could you get? Mr. Football, at the home of football with his son.
That must have been a bittersweet moment for you. It was a magnificent tribute to EJ, but you're sitting in the car on public display with your dying father.
Yes, it was a pretty hard thing to do because my emotions were going all over the place. You know, I was so proud to be able to be doing it with Dad. On the other hand, here he is, I'm holding him up and he's saying goodbye to the football public for the last time, unable to see because he'd had a stroke.
I remember talking to you at the time about he was in pain the whole time, wasn't he?
Yes, he was always in pain because he'd been through 4 years of radiation. Yeah. And obviously the cancer had affected a lot of other parts of his body. He was blind, he was very cold, and so it took an amazing effort for him to be able to be on the ground at the time and going around it.
What was the dialogue on the way around? Were you just telling him where you were or what did he talk to you?
Yes, we were talking all the way around, but because he couldn't see, he was asking me where we were positioned on the ground. Mm. He was asking me where the MCC members were, where the commentators were.
He didn't want to stick it up the MCC members,
did he? Yes, he did. Well, and he did. He just got to a point where he put his arm around me and rested his head on my shoulder in a very beautiful moment.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's something that I see all the time on the video vision of that day, which it really makes me emotional too.
Yeah. You're 58 years of age now.
Yes.
EJ was 62 when he died.
Yes.
What's the message there?
Well, certainly the message is that something Dad didn't receive, and that is for all men to look after themselves, to start having annual checkups, not just for prostate cancer, but for all other things that can go wrong with a man as he gets older in life.
EJ Whitten, a great man, proud of his family and proud of his... magnificent contribution to the best game in the world.
Whitten and South Australian legend Neil Curley were bitter on-field rivals at interstate level who became great friends as ambassadors of their respective states.
I want to take you back to 1995, a state game at the MCG, Victoria, South Australia. You met him at the end of the lap. You almost seemed like you jumped in front of the car. Is that how it transpired?
I saw him coming and I thought, gee, I've got to say g'day to the old fella. And so I just walked in front of the car. And then I heard young Ted say, it's Knuckles, Dad, it's Knuckles. What's he on? And then we sort of hugged each other a bit and said hello. I can't say what I said to him.
Why not?
Well, because it's going to air. Because I swore at him. Yeah.
Well, try a sign, mate. What did you say to him?
I just said, yeah, you can't keep your nose out of it, can you? You've got to be involved, haven't you? We're going to stick it up, you bastards. Yeah. And that's what he said. And I said, well, good luck. And did they ever stick it up?
Did you cry then?
I was close to it. I really was. It got me.
I can't remember another sporting moment like it. I mean, there was this eerie silence. Everyone knew what his fate was. And silence. I think there were probably 40-odd thousand people at the G.
I was just going to try and say the same, maybe a tad more, but there wasn't a squeak. Like, you could have heard a mouse run across the floor. They were just deathly silence. And that's the respect I had for the man. And it was incredible, amazing. One of the most amazing scenes I've ever witnessed.
Three-time Brownlow medal winner Bob Skilton played his first VFL game against Whitten's Footscray. They became lifelong friends.
I still think that is the moment in football that I remember most. To think that Ked was blind and in the rooms before the game, to see him, having to be told, look, Ablett's coming up and whatever. And, Ted was just that way. You wouldn't have known that he couldn't see because once he knew that it was Ablett, he acted like he could see Gary. And then when young Ted and old Ted went around in the car, I don't think I've ever experienced... it wasn't just a moment. It was sort of the whole time. And I was standing with Ted's brother, Donnie, on the fence up from the rooms because the players were down warming up and at this stage I was crying and I thought, well, I'm better off downstairs and I went downstairs and the players were warming up and everything. I got tears running down my face. I thought, no, I'm better off upstairs. So I went back up again with Donnie and then as they passed us and I saw the car stop and Curls come out and shake hands with Ted.
How were you at the end of that lap when Neil Curley appeared? There's Danny Frawley with the tears falling down his cheeks, Curls the same. How were you then in an emotional sense?
Yeah, I was pretty shot, but I had a job to do, and that was to look after him on the day and make sure he was okay. And that's what I concentrated on, and I really tried to have a bit of fun with him on the way around because, as I said, he was waving goodbye to people and I could see them in the crowd with tears streaming down their face. And, for a young bloke like myself at the time to see that those people crying for my father was very emotional.
Danny Frawley helped nurse EJ through his highly emotional public farewell at the MCG in 1995. Danny, you were his eyes and ears that day and you're an emotional man. How did you cope?
Not many people realised that he was just about totally blind as well. So I was being his chaperone in the rooms and he sat next to me. So I would whisper in his ear that Gary Ablett was coming over because he didn't want to let them know that he was struggling. And he'd stand up and Gary would wish him all the best. And then, the late Jim Steins and Steve Silvani, and they embraced. And you could just sense that there was something special going on. And you could have cut the air with a knife. And then I got the big fella, Tony, to come over and plugger in his wables. Are you all right? And Teddy goes, don't worry about me. You just go out and kick some goals, which he did. He ended up kicking eight and won the EJ Whitten medal. And then out of the corner of my eye, I saw Curley there. And I said, Curley's here. And Teddy stood up and said, who in the bloody hell let him in? I said, no, it's Rod Curley Austin, the coach. And when you see guys like Gary Ablett and Lockett, who were just modern day gladiators, to see them tear up was only human nature that I was going to tear up as well. And as I said, I am an emotional type of person, but when you see Gary Lyon and the late Jim Steins and Silvani and Brett Ratton and all those guys tear up as well, you knew Victoria were going to smash it.
The lead by Ablett is gone. Now, you would have to say that that was magical stuff by Gary Ablett.
Really, it was just great bodywork. Knowing where your opponent is, beautifully done.
Ablett from 35 metres.
What were your last words with him, Danny? What was the exchange between you and EJ when you knew you'd never see him again?
He said, Sputter, I'll never forget what you've done for me today. I didn't play in a flag or a premiership, anything like that, but that was the most incredible day that I've had involved in football, by a long way.
EJ has left an indelible impression on the Bulldogs. He was Doug Hawkins' idol and remains a strong spiritual inspiration for Bob Murphy and his red, white and blue teammates.
Do the younger players understand who he was and the profound influence he had on this football club?
It's a good question. I think so. I think because of that, because of the iconic stuff, he was, you know, that the stuff with the big V, the lap around the MCG there, they sort of, well, they do, they go beyond the normal footy folklore stuff, and I was 13 when, but that's burnt in my memory of, you know, I can remember it really clearly of, and it, even for, you know, a young kid, you know, you got the importance of it and the significance of what he was to the game.
Where were you the day the car went around the MCG with the two Whittons in it?
Another regret, Mike.
You didn't go?
No. I didn't go because when I spoke to young Ted, he said that Dad's not going to make the day because he's not well enough. And I was playing at Fitzroy, then obviously a state game, I'm not involved. I took my family up to Rich River. I'll never forget it. I didn't think he was going to be there. And then when I got up to Rich River, it was late, it would have been 4:35, and had the kids on board. Three children and Raylan. I went inside, turned the telly on, and there was I saw it straight away, Ted doing a lap. I'm standing there crying. Raylan walks and said, what are you crying about? I said, Teddy made it to the MCG. I should be there, you know, and I wasn't there, Mike. No, I missed that one, and it was something special.
It haunts you a bit, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does a bit, you know, and again, I get... When I talk about Ted, I love Ted. He was the best, and I should have been there, you know, to more or less have my goodbye type of thing, you know. I mean, that was one of the most amazing things I've ever seen at the MCG ever. I wasn't there to be a part of that. That's life, mate, isn't it?
He was at home after the game, and I walked down to the driveway, and he came to the front door, and he just stood there and said, "The Vicks are back in town,"
really,
which is one of his favourite statements.
Yeah.
Good old Victoria, can you still agree? Victoria, the champions, just you wait and see.
Whitten on to Spargo, picked up by Spargo, into Ted Whitten, a short hand pass to Bissett, beautiful football, up to Ted Whitten, a lovely hand pass, look at that.
A perfect hand pass by Gosper to Spargo, I'm sure he didn't mean that
much. Oh, look at that.
Takes a beautiful mark, great anticipation. It's in a half ball, Whitten moves into position, and a beautiful mark. Whitten goes over, here's a chance for Whitten, oh, he gets it to Williams there, Schultz now.
John Schultz was Witten's brother-in-arms at Footscray, where he won five Best and Fairests and a Brownlow medal during the 1960s. John Nicholls was his fellow Big V warrior. John Nicholls, your memories of Mr. Football?
Well, it's a lot. Over a long period of time, we played together state sides. EJ was probably the king when I started playing for Victoria. But Footscray, look, he was such a showman, such a great player, certainly the best player I've seen. Could play in so many positions, and equally as well, back, forward, ruck, you know, put him on the wing. He can get a kick anywhere because he had skill and pace and fitness. He was a showman. Sometimes you never really know what he was thinking. You know, he was such an actor or a showman, but he loved the game, he loved Footscray, and that was his life.
John Schultz, you were a shy boy from Bort in country Victoria via Caulfield Grammar. What are your earliest memories of Witten at the Witten Oval?
Well, I came down in 1958. I'd been, had a practice match in 57, came down from Bort, played the practice match and then signed up and then came down in 58. And Ted, all my career, he was like a big brother to me. He was a bit older, not too much older, but he was there to look after you. And it wasn't just me individually, but the anyone that played with him would think of him in that role. He was the father figure, the brother, the protector. And you'll have players today that they'll say, well, we didn't see, we won 54, we won the premiership in 54, and Ted was playing that with Charlie, and they were Charlie's boys. But if you ask any of the players that played with Ted, they'll say, well, you know, I didn't win a premiership or a grand final, but I played with Ted Witten. And that's the thing they could hang their hat on, you know, the fact that they played with. He was one of those fellows that he took part in life to the hilt, you know, and you say he died at 62, which he did, was very young, particularly in this day and age. But in living those 62 years, he put two lives in every year. He really lived life. And he was into it full on, and it was, from his perspective, it was just very sad that he couldn't continue doing what he did, because he was a marvellous person. But on the field, he was a showman, but he could still play great football.
Neil could fall into a trap here. He's walked down. He doesn't know that Witten's gone back. Yes, I thought he did, yes. Good football, Ted Witten. That's using your head.
So the greats of the game, and there are lots of them, you two are included in it. You've got Witten at one, clearly.
Yes.
Yeah. Schultz, yes. Same? Yeah. Well, it's a massive accolade. We've seen a lot of good footballers, you two, haven't you?
A very close number two was Skilton.
Mm-hmm.
And they were good mates too.
Yeah, they were. Bobby, EJ looked after you in state games, didn't he? Well, at least that's what he told us.
No, that was true. I think it was the fact that my first game was against the Bulldogs. And, you know, whether it was because we were both sharing the bottom of the ladder often in those times, and but right from the start, my first state game, you know, Teddy said, "I'll look after you, mate," and he became a mate, a true mate, right throughout, and right to his to the day he died, he was that way.
He was known as Mr. Football, despite the fact that Ron Barassi won six premierships and EJ won. Did we get it right?
I think so. Yeah, he's still. He's still, you know, he's still my number one.
Still the best player you've ever seen.
Yeah, I think, yeah, because he could play centre half back, centre half forward, and so on. You know, there's lots of players that I put in the absolute champion category, and you know, to me, you don't separate them, because you know they're just great players, and it's hard to pick one against the other.
Witten and six-time premiership player Ron Barassi vied for the title of Mr. Football throughout their brilliant careers. This is the contentious part, Ronnie. He was seen to be Mr. Football. He called himself Mr. Football, and he called you Mrs. Football. How did you react to that?
Well, I wouldn't have liked that. But I never got fussed about it, except that in a situation where you had a microphone or a stage, you know, you'd put on a bit of an act, and we'd have a verbal tussle about who was Mr. Football, who deserved to be Mr. Football.
Well, answer that. Tell me the answer to that. I mean, EJ, as
great player, one premiership. Ron Barassi, great player, six premierships.
Well, of course, I'm Mr. Football.
Whenever I refer to EJ as Mr. Football, you say, Mr. Football in Victoria, that's all.
Yeah, well, he never played in South Australia. So he couldn't be Mr. Football over there.
So who, you know, all due modesty aside...
I'll let you answer that one.
All due modesty aside, who was Mr. Football in South Australia?
I'll let you answer that.
Do you see EJ as Mr. Football?
I think to what he did off the field. Like you've got Brass.
You see, Brass won six premierships.
I know, played in six premierships. Yeah, well, he was in a better side. But what a player and what a leader, inspiration. They both were the same. But EJ did more to promote off the field than Ron did. I know Ron did his bit, but EJ, I don't know, he got in front of the camera more and...
He was louder, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was to a degree, but both brilliant ambassadors for the game. Mm. Outstanding ambassadors. Maybe EJ just a bit above Ronald Dale.
Growing up, footy players to me always seemed like superheroes. And then once you get drafted and then you play with them and you get to meet some of them, and then maybe sadly you kind of realise they're just blokes. But because I never got to meet Ted, I never got to meet the man, and he is still like a larger than life sort of superhero.
He's normally a prolific kick. I know it's a heavy ball, but he'll be putting everything he's got into this. It's a torpedo punt. It's going goalward. It's gone right through it.
Do you wonder, could he have been that good, or is there a romance about it or not?
A bit. Especially because people around here and at our footy club, because he was a part of that golden era as well, and he was Charlie Sutton was the hard leader, and Ted was the kind of flamboyant, star. And people still, I bumped into a guy, having a coffee before, who's in his 80s, and he said that he'd, grown up watching Ted, and that will happen, if not daily, at least every week, if someone said, I saw him, I played, and they always finish it with it, he was the best. Just to, in case you'd forgotten, he was the best.
It's not a question, is it? It's a statement.
No, yeah, yeah. It's something for you to leave with. Yeah.
What made EJ special on the field?
Well, you name me any player that could play any position on the ground. EJ was that person. He could just adapt, and he was such an inspirational player. He would drag players with him and make them better. He was a true champion.
Where you saw him at his best was in state football, because he could do what he wanted to do. He wasn't restricted by coaching and captaining. He'd play a position that he was well suited to, but he couldn't do that in club football because he needed to be everywhere. So a lot of his game was taken away by the fact that he, in a way, had to plug holes or be where the ball was and couldn't settle in his natural position.
Puts it in trouble across to Whitten. Whitten, there's nobody home. He has a clear go. He steadies his shoot. Put it through.
What did you know of EJ the coach? I mean, there's that famous vision of him imploring his players to get him over, to get the team over the line in his last game at the Western Oval.
Well, I don't know too much, except I know him as a person and as a teammate and all that sort of thing, with the Victorian setup. I knew that he could talk. He was very an easy talker, and I'd seen television of him and all that sort of stuff. So he'd be a hell of a person to rev you up, really.
He was a lad, wasn't he, EJ?
A lovable larrikin. Yeah, you could put it that way. But my boys, if ever Ted was coming down to home, they were just wrapped, and they would then say, can we bring some of my mates? And I used to have to say, well, you can't bring that many and whatever. But all they really wanted was to see their mates when Teddy shook hands with them, because Ted had an infamous handshake, which is great. Everybody should have a nice, firm handshake.
Hey, that was not more than nice and firm, Bobby.
It was. And, my boys would get absolute delight out of seeing the looks on their mate's face after Teddy shook hands. And, it was always great to be, in his company.
Did you love him?
Well, I guess you could use that word, yeah. I guess you could. I don't use that word very often.
You can say it.
I like people, but I don't. I guess I love a few, yeah. He was one of them.
And he was one.
Yeah.
There you go, Ted!
Ron, I want to remind you of a state trip. Victoria playing in Adelaide.
Yes, I know the one you mean.
Now, for reasons that escape me, you were outside your room, the door's locked, you have no clothes on. The only room you know is the one occupied by Ted Whitten. Pick up the story from there.
I knocked on the door.
Whose door?
Teddy's. I knew it was Teddy was there. So we're talking through the door. I'm out here. I haven't got any clothes on. And he said, you haven't got any clothes on, Ron. I said, no, Ted. Ted, will you hurry up? And he said, now, Ron, this thing about Mr. Football, we've got to make it up, you know. You know that I am. This is him. You know that I am Mr. Football.
And I'm making a pass to Ted Whitten.
Hi, Norman.
Hi, Ted. I see you're wearing your Jonko football shorts, the shorts worn by the champions.
Norman, I've proved that Jonko footy shorts are the best you can play in. Plenty of leg room and comfy around the waist.
That's right. Jonko shorts are triple stitch from Fleecy Line Drill. Man, Jonko's tough. Show us how you can kick in your Jonko shorts, Ted. Ha-ha! Kids, ask for Jonko football shorts, worn by champions.
Well, Ted, how does it feel to be walking down this lane, approaching the ground for your last game?
It feels bloody awful, David.
Does it?
I don't feel very happy about it at all. But, it has to come, and this is it. The skies haven't been too good to us either, really.
I suppose it's the sort of day that you've been waiting for and anticipating and yet have been dreading at the same time.
That's exactly right. You've struck the nail right on the head. It's been a long time coming. I didn't think the day would ever arrive. And this last week has been absolutely out of this world. There's been that much pressure and tension applied. It's been very difficult to find time to do any work, as the saying goes, with commitments. But now that it has come, it's come too quickly.
So, Alan, you inherited the famous number three jumper at 16 years of age. How do we know that jumper is the real deal, the original?
Well, it's a real deal because the property steward pulled it out on the Tuesday night and I tried it on. It was about 10 sizes too big, so we had to have it stitched. He took it home to his wife and she cut it and stitched it up, so there it is. That's the real McCoy.
Coming now, here he is. Ted Whitten.
So how does it feel, that jumper over your arm? I mean, this is your football life in front of you, isn't it?
Well, very much so. I used to wear Ted's number as a kid before I even went to Footscray. Every Saturday, my grandmother and I, Nan, used to go to the footy. The number three was on the back and away we went. And then years later, I had the opportunity to get the number three, so it was sensational. The fact that you always wanted to play league footy, but I spoke to Mum and Dad about number three. How good's that to actually get Ted's jumper? It was extraordinary. You know, it was every kid's dream. Every kid in Footscray wore number three, and there I am getting it myself. I think a season before at the junior program at the club, and they get a lot of kids down to come and train and play and in practice games and that sort of thing. And I remember he said to me, son, you better get down here and play. I want you to come. And, you know, I was about just 15 at the time, and I remember I thought, if he shakes my hand like that again, I'll never be able to move my arm, let alone play footy. But once again, it was that handshake, just near ripped it off my arm and said, you better come and play.
Did EJ present you with that jumper?
Well, he actually presented me with the jumper at Skinner Reserve, where I played my football before Footscray.
Not at the Western Oval?
Not at the Western Oval. He wasn't coaching those days, Rosie was. And Rosie presented me with the jumper on the Wednesday night, I think, before the game. The following week, EJ bought a jumper to Skinner Reserve and said, son, wear it with pride. And
so he set that up with the local paper?
Yeah, with the advertising. he was a marketing guru. He loved it. And there was no bigger personality in the game, and you'd be hard-pressed today to find another one.
What a lovely pie, me boys, a 4 and 25. A lovely tasty pastry in a 4 and 25. Lots of lovely tender meat, the finest you can buy. Oh, what a lovely pie, me boys, a 4 and 25.
I know it's 20 years and it's a long time, but you were such a dear friend. Do you still miss him?
I've got a a series of tapes, you know, the old tapes and a few DVDs of Ted and his career and that sort of thing. And we've got a group that have got together and we've played them all. It's the Witten Tragics, we call them, but when you get it all together, condensed like that, you realise what a great person he was and what a great player. On television, he was a star.
Stop the crow eaters.
The mental life's changed so much. I mean, the days that you look at those old, you know, those old films and tapes, you know, playing Saturday afternoon on wet, boggy grounds, and, you know, we had one pair of boots. EJ may have had more because he worked with Adidas. But I mean, we had poor equipment. You know, you play the game with one ball. The ball was just so heavy by the time it was over, and we had a lot of wet winters.
Have a look at this.
Oh, that's right, the other ball's been returned. That's what Witten's saying.
That's good tactics now. Look, they're playing well, they're marking better, and Ted wants a drier ball.
If he was playing today's style, today's training and today's equipment, he'd be even better again.
Big kick too, right in towards centre-half forward. Witten jockeying away there with Breen. Oh, look at that for judgment.
Now he'd be about 80 yards out here. Up he comes. Got the wind behind him. He's kicked this a mile. Look at it. Oh, my.
Can you see anybody else getting close to that number of games in the hurly-burly of footballers that's played now in the 70s?
I think they'd have to be very lucky, Ron, injury-wise, and they would have a chance, but I believe it'll be very hard with the way, as you say, the hurly-burly of the game is today, to get near it.
You loved him, didn't you?
Yeah, I did, Mike. I loved EJ. He was special.
It still seems that you can't quite believe that the record you're going to break is of the bloke next year.
Well, Jeff, yeah, it's right. You make me laugh, EJ. You know, I'd love to go to sleep tonight, Ted.
Yeah.
And wake up this Monday morning.
Yeah, I will.
Can
it
we
won't,
do that?
It won't take long.
Can we do that?
No, not really. I mean, you've got to go through the day, and you've got to front up to it, son. You've done it already for 3:21, yeah.
He was a great man. He was a bit of a rogue, a bit of a villain.
Bit of a rogue, yeah.
From Braybrook.
Like your good self?
Yeah, like myself, and that Braybrook element. And he was a role model for us young boys in Braybrook as we were growing up. You know, if Teddy Witten could do it and make the big time at Footscray, well, so could we.
Now, Ted, the other day when there was a chance, there seemed some kind of vague chance that Doug was going to say, no, that's enough.
Yeah.
We'll both have 3:21. What did you think of that?
Oh, mate, I could have swam from here to Tasmania underwater. I thought at long last, he's come to his senses.
You ended up breaking EJ's record here for games played. Special day in your life, I suspect.
Mike, it was it. I mean, at the end of the day, footy's about team. That was Dougie Hawkins' grand final. It was special. Do I belong on the same stage? No. I got a telegram back in those days. You get a telegram. It was from Ted Witten. Special.
What did it say?
Listen, son, you get out there. It's your big day next week. You deserve to be there. You get out there and you stick it up. And it was fantastic. It just changed everything. Like, it really changed how I felt. I believed I belonged there. You know, Teddy had his grandstand on the outer wing, tin shed out in the outer wing, which he reminded me of a fair bit of. He came down the rooms before the game. He gave me the old handshake. So we broke three fingers of mine. To have him here, Mike, was really, really special. And to run down the banner from a good mate, Steve McPherson. Luke Beveridge was the other guy that was on the bench with us that day. And to have my children with me and to go for the banner and have Ted to greet me was just something that you don't forget that. These memories for me forever, they're special.
EJ, it all sounds like football to me.
It
It's been a very emotional night, and we've just heard some news through which I'm sure will touch the hearts of all football supporters. We've only just found out in the break that the great EJ Whitten, Ted Whitten, has passed away tonight.
You crossed this line.
Dougie, the night that EJ died, I think it was footy show night, wasn't it?
Yeah, footy show.
You were on the panel?
Yep.
Yeah. You're an emotional man anyway. You're either laughing or you're crying, but that really just did cut you deeply, didn't it?
Yeah, it did, Mike. It really did. We and I, you know, the footy show guys, you know, including Sam Newman, who was very close to Teddy as well, we knew he was pretty crook. And Mike, that's one of my biggest regrets in life. I didn't go to see him towards the end. I didn't want to remember him how he, you know, I remember him how he was and not, you know, how he was going towards the end, you know, with the stroke and nearly going blind and all that sort of stuff. I couldn't see him like that.
Maybe he needed to see you.
Yeah, I was probably being a bit, you know, a bit not selfish or greedy, but I didn't want to, you know, I said to young Ted, I regret it now, I probably should have done it. But that night when Eddie broke the news, I think it was late, it was probably the last break, 10 o'clock break of the footy show, and he came over and just said, oh, Ted's passed away half an hour ago.
Mm.
And I remember him coming back, and he went to Sam, and Sam couldn't hardly even speak. And then he came to me, and I don't know what I said. I think I said, I love Ted, he was a great man. And I drove home that night, it was hard.
The image that we all grew up with EJ was that he was indestructible.
Yeah.
He was invincible. You know, nothing would happen to EJ. He played every week. He lived till for 1,000 years. Were you angry that he didn't do anything about looking after his health?
Oh, yes, I was. I would have expected him to be at least going to the doctor when he had a problem, whether it be a cold to get some antibiotics or whether it was other issues. But apparently he used to just wait for a symptom to occur before he'd do anything. And sometimes, as we know now, symptoms for prostate cancer in particular, they can take your life.
Was there a moment when you realised that EJ was in big trouble in terms of his health?
Yeah, there was, actually. We had an Australia-Irish rules game at Waverley, and on the way home, we stopped half a dozen times for Dad to go to the toilet. And when we stopped for the last time at Leonda on the banks of the Yarra, I said, geez, you're going to the toilet a fair bit. He said, yeah, I'm really struggling. I said, what do you mean? He said, it's just as a drip. I said, well, what have you done about it? Have you seen anybody about it? He said, no. I said, well, how long has it been going on? He said, 2 years.
Wow.
I said, 2 years. So I demanded that we go to the doctor the next day. That was the first I knew about it, but that trip to the doctor told us that he had incurable prostate cancer.
So it was too late then?
It was way too late. It had got into the bones, and it was 4 years of treatment and going downhill in a slow, painful death.
Good morning and welcome to St Patrick's Roman Catholic Cathedral here in Melbourne for the state funeral of Mr Football, Ted Whitten. It's testimony to the character of the great EJ that such a unique honour be bestowed upon a boy from Braybrook who left school at 13 years of age and made his name playing football. And so too is this telecast unique with my colleague from Seven Sport, Bruce McAvaney, joining me. Bruce, good morning.
Good morning, Ed. Yes, it's great that Seven and Nine are together today to farewell Ted Whitten, who's been both a friend and a colleague. As a player, coach and commentator, Ted Whitten has been the heart and soul of football, and that's reflected in the huge turnout today.
We lose EJ. Outpouring of emotion was huge, probably in Australia, certainly in Victoria.
It gripped the nation. It did.
Yeah.
It had an effect on the nation.
Yeah, yeah. You ended up being a pallbearer at the funeral. Well, funeral, wasn't it? St Pat's Cathedral.
Oh, it was a tremendous honour, I felt, to be asked to do that, which I accepted, of course, greatly. And, yeah, what a day. Like, what about the number of people?
Mm.
You know, they couldn't get in. And then the streets were just lined. Incredible. You know, he went at least 15 years too, 20 years too early.
No doubt.
Like, I'm his age. And
and he's been gone 20 years.
Yeah.
It's just too soon, isn't it?
Way too soon for anybody.
Those not fortunate to know him personally may well find it hard to believe that seemingly brash, arrogant maniac hamming it up with curls before a state of origin could, within seconds, become the most warm, caring, compassionate, generous person one could know.
That morning I was walking my dogs around the, you know, the St Kilda ground in Moorabbin and going through what I was going to say, and I think I broke down three times. I went home and said to Marion, I can't do it. She said, you'll make it. If I'd have gone another 30 seconds, I'd have been gone, I reckon. Yeah.
From the fading sky, a hope.
That last day, Danny, did he talk about the pain, the frustration? Did he talk about dying? Did that come up?
Look, he did. He talked about the fact that how stubborn he was and what a competitor that he was. And I think it was a great example for everyone, including me, that he thought he was 10 foot tall and bulletproof. And I think that's a great example for all males aged 40, 50 or 60, whatever it is. Get to the bloody doctor if you feel crook.
Now, the footy club at the moment's doing a Sons of the West program. It's sensational, fantastic. From last year, it's tripled in volume of numbers of blokes now looking after themselves or getting themselves better. And EJ, again, I'll say it, if he got treated early, I reckon he'd still be here. I reckon he'd still be here. And that was a message to me that after you hit 50, get your month now, get your 12 months checkup. And I do that, you know, and that was a message that I got from Teddy Whitten, the great EJ, you know. We're not invincible.
If he hadn't been so stubborn, he might be still here now. And I think that, you know, the EJ Whitten Foundation is probably testament to the fact that there's a lot of, he saved a hell of a lot of lives by losing his life.
It's well put. I'll leave you with this sobering fact. Do you happen to know how old he was, or in fact how young he was, when he passed?
Look, from memory, I think he was just 60.
62.
Yep.
62.
Yeah, too young. 62, he still had a lot more to give.
Tell me what you see, how you see EJ Whitten Sr.'s legacy to football and to Victoria.
Well, certainly his legacy now with the work we're doing at the EJ Whitten Foundation is fantastic, because we are using his name and his profile and now the foundation to be able to help men save lives.
There's the message there for every bloke that it doesn't matter how big you've been or how strong you might seem, it can get you, can't it?
It certainly can. And, you know, some of the guys who think they're invincible, they really they struggle to go to the doctor, and, you know, they really must understand that for their own sake or their family's sake, they need to look after themselves.
I said to you at half-time that providing we control the rucks in the air like we were doing, we've got a real chance. You had them in your hand and you've let them out. They want attacking purposeful football all the time.
The ghost of Ted Whitten. Are you in regular contact with it?
I don't know if I'm in contact, but I'm kind of open to the mystique of footy. And Ted's such a huge figure at our footy club.
Excuse me for a while. While I'm wide-eyed and I'm so down caught in the middle.
So when you hear the name Ted Whitten, what sort of thoughts does it evoke from you?
When you say that, I think of Ted, I think of a winner. And I don't think that's probably not something you associate firsthand from the Bulldogs or past Bulldogs player, but he was a, you know, premiership player here. A big V, he was a dominant winner.
If a child cries, but you not give them.
It's almost like a noise, like a the sound of victory, that euphoric growl of a man, you know, when he's the fist pumping. It's more that. It's more the crowd behind him and him sort of pumping his fist. I don't know how to explain that, but it's more of a sound than anything else.
It's got to be a do or die effort. It's got to be a determined bit. You've got to show me all the guts and all the determination you've got in your body. You've got to inspire me with this last quarter bit. You've been in front all day and you've got to stay there. Are you going to sit there? We want a big effort there. Come on, fella.
Do you miss him?
Oh, of course, Mike. I was an only child and, you know, I in my work, I see him every day. You know, photos in the office, video, vision everywhere we go. I cross the E.J. Witten Bridge, I get into the Bulldogs, yeah. And there's a grandstand, a street, a statue.
Yeah.
And so I can still hear him talking to me every day.
I'll send a message to him. He's not with us, as we know, so I've got to talk downwards. Sorry, mate. You were the best. You were the best. You were Mr. Football.
You don't mean that, Ron.
No, I don't mean that.
And Witten has the chance of putting Footscray in front. His kick floats the front kick. It's just fairly good to me. It's thrown. Footscray have hit the front.
Excuse me for a while I'm wide-eyed and I'm so down caught in the middle.
This has been a Fox Footy production. Part of the Fox Sports Network.